programming, and if suppose we want to load some external data from external source into the R environment, then how to handle that data, that also will see today. So I will start with the MATLAB first. I will go through the MATLAB basics, and if time permits, I will show you a small analysis on COVID-19 data set, and we will see how to load the data and how to analyze it. So I'm sharing my MATLAB screen here. Is the screen visible now? Hope my screen is visible here. So I'm here with the MATLAB environment. It is one of the most powerful tool when we talk about the research. Basically, MATLAB is found popular with the experiments with image processing, then video processing, even neural network and fuzzy logic, as well as genetic algorithm. So there are many toolboxes supported by MATLAB. I'm using here MATLAB release of 2015A. It is a very old release, but there are the latest release available on MathWork website. If you want to have a trial version of it, you can download. The basic commands and constructs I'll be demonstrating here. For that, this old version is sufficient. So MATLAB here is basically a matrix laboratory. Everything we take here, even the object or some variable, that is treated as a matrix. So in this matrix laboratory, we have variety of the tools, but it is up to you that in what domain you are working. Like suppose you are working in the image processing, so you need to explore the image processing toolbox. And if you are performing some research in image processing along with, say, deep learning, so you need to explore the deep learning toolbox as well. So it's not compulsory that you should know all the toolboxes. It is as per our need, we decide what toolbox to be chosen for our research work. So this is nothing but the MATLAB environment. Here, you're observing the command prompt. This is my working place. I'll be executing the commands over here. On top of it, here goes my file editor. I can create the MATLAB script, and I can save those MATLAB scripts with the .m extension. Beside that, on left-hand side, you're observing the current working folder where I'm working presently. Here, I'm in C drive with the admin folder, and this is the workspace. As soon as you start working with the command prompt, you're going to create different objects. Those objects will be listed over here. Just like we have seen yesterday in the environment tab of R programming. So this is the work place. First command I'll be executing here, CLC. That is nothing but I want to clear out the screen over here. It is a little slow because I'm running too many programs over here. So there are two commands we will commonly use. One is CLC to clear out the screen, and another one is clear. So when we say clear, all the objects you created so far, those objects will be removed from your workspace. They won't be longer available. So for example, I want to have some object like this, x equals to 5. So just like R programming, we need not declare variable here. So I just want to have a value 5 here in x, so I created x. Similarly, I want to have something in y, say y equals to 20. So these two objects are created, and if you click on the work space, you can see x and y created over here. Even you can see the values. Now see the representation of these objects, x and y. They are represented as matrices. Since it is a matrix laboratory, everything you take here is treated as a matrix. So these two objects I have created without any declaration. So we will perform here clear now. This will remove the objects you created so far from the workspace. So as soon as we execute clear, just have a look at workspace. See, X and Y have been removed from the workspace. Now we will see some of the useful commands and functions in MATLAB, and slowly we will move to the basics of image processing, how to load image, how to work with the images, how to perform filtering, all that. So let us go through some basic commands. In MATLAB environment, AMS is the default variable here. Whatever you perform, its result will be going to ANS variable by default. For example, I perform something like this, 10 plus 20. So this expression's evaluation, I'm not holding in any variable. So 10 plus 30 is executed, and by default, the result is directed to variable ANS. So if you go to the workspace, you will find that the default variable ANS is created, and it holds the result of addition. So ANS is very important variable here. Then there is, let us have some object like X I want to have, Y, something like this. Some value in Y, say Y equals to 12. Now I will go for the next command as hoop. This command will tell me what all objects are there in my workspace. So when you say hoop, these are the objects. ANS we created earlier, then we created X, then we created Y. So who will give you the list of all objects available. Another equivalent command is whose, like WHOS. When we say whose, this will give us the list of objects available in the workspace along with the type of value it holds, the size of that object, and what is the class, the data type. So like ANS, it is 1 by 1, it holds a single value, 8 bytes, so it holds because that is an integer value, and the class, the data type is double. Same is for X and Y. So that is the difference between who and whose. Who gives you simply the list of objects from the workspace, while whose gives you the list of objects along with its size, its class and bytes and attributes. Next important command here is global, but presently we will not be able to use this. Like something, if you want to have as a global, for example, this variable X, I want to use everywhere, I want to use it globally. So I will make it as a global. I will take different variables, say global Z. I will make this variable as a global, say Z is global now. And this can be used in different functions. When you write functions in MATLAB and call them anywhere required, but you want some variable or some object common in all the functions. So you can make that variable as global and use it ahead. That is about global variable. The next important element is pi. The value of pi, 3.14 is available. Then even you can check for the system date by this command. Date, it will give you the system date like this. Present current working directory you can check by pwd command. So let us check in which directory we are working presently. So we are working in the C drive, user and admin. This command is useful when you want to see where your work is located, and if you want to save all your executions in particular folder, then you can go for the common command called change directory. So here if I give change directory to some new directory which is there in admin folder, my path will get changed. So these are similar to the DOS commands we used to execute with the DOS prompt. Next, there is a display function. It is just like the print function. Any message if you want to display, so like welcome to MATLAB, I'm saying, so this will be displayed here. Okay, this is useful when we program with the MATLAB scripts. So these are very general functionalities we are exploring. Let us generate some data now with the built-in functions. Like we can generate here vectors. like the linear vectors in linear form also we can generate, even we can generate them in the rectangular representation. For example, I want to have say one matrix of zeros. So there is a built-in function called zeros, and let us have three rows and four columns in that matrix. So this is 3 by 4 matrix, and this is a matrix of zeros. Okay, so we have generated this with zeros. Like if I want to have zeros with the dimension say 4 by 4, so it will be generating a matrix of 4 by 4. Similarly, we can generate the matrix of ones. For that, the built-in function is ONES, and here you need to give the dimension. Like 5 by 6 matrix of ones I want to generate. So just give the dimension 5 rows and 6 columns. See, 5 rows and 6 columns of ones are generated. These are really helpful built-in functionalities in image processing. Then even you can generate the matrix of logical ones, like something like true and false. Let us create for the logical ones. Suppose we create for logical one, the function is true function, and we want to have a matrix of logical one with the dimension 3 by 3. So this will generate a 3 by 3 matrix of logical one. Please make a note of this difference. Earlier we generated ones using ones function. Those were not the logical ones. Here one means true. So this is a matrix of logical ones. Similarly, you can generate the matrix for false. So the built-in functionality is false, and like I want to have a dimension as 3 rows and 4 columns. So this is a logical zero value here everywhere in this matrix. So this is a matrix of logical zeros. So dimension you can give as per your requirement. Another one we can generate, like identity matrix you can generate. For that, the built-in functionality is I, and identity matrix of say 5 rows and 5 columns. Suppose we generate, just have a look at this matrix. We have five rows and five columns here, and all the diagonal elements are set to 1. So like this, we can operate with many built-in functionalities. We can perform vector operations also, just like we perform in the R environment. Like suppose we have some data in variable or object X, like I have 10 and 20. So using this notation, we can create the vector. Like I want to have 10 and 20 in variable X or in object. Similarly, let us have something in Y. I will have the values say 34 and 45 in Y. So these are now two vectors. We can concatenate them simply by having the expression in square bracket X space Y. It means we are telling a MATLAB compiler here to concatenate the data elements available in X with the data elements available in Y. So see the concatenation, elements of X followed by elements of Y. Even this we can hold in some variable say A, and now this is stored as an object here. It will be available here in A. By default it went to the ANS variable. Earlier we did not assign any variable name. With these vectors X and Y, you can perform the arithmetic operations. Like no doubt you can go for X plus Y. Of course, the dimensions of the vectors must match. You can go for X minus Y. So this is the operation. Even you can go for the transpose of this. I am calling it as a linear vector. In fact, it is one-dimensional matrix we have. So we can go for the transpose of it. Like let us have a look at X data, we have 10 and 20. If we want transpose of it, so just have this notation x followed by a quote, a single quote. It is transpose. It was a row earlier. It was a linear vector, a row vector. It is converted into a column vector. Like you can go for the transpose of two-dimensional matrices also. So in this way, we can perform all the arithmetic operations with the vectors and with matrices in MATLAB. If we recall, yesterday we have seen one range construct in the R environment. Like we can generate the sequence from some lower limit to upper limit. Even we can generate the sequence with a particular state difference. That's also possible here in MATLAB environment. Like suppose we generate the range from 1 to 10. So simply we will put it as 1:10. These 10 values are generated where 1 is the lower limit and 10 is the upper limit. But if we want to generate the range with a specific state difference, so the notation is different. Like we start with some lower limits, say 10 is our lower limit. We want the step difference of 3 and we want upper limit as 15. So 10:3:15, this is lower limit, this is the step difference and 50 is the upper limit. So if we say enter, look at the data generated. We started with 10, then 13, 16 because of step difference 3. And see at the end, we are not getting the value as 50 because it do not fit with the step difference. So what is the last value fitting in this range? It is 49. So that is the last value generated. This way we can generate the range with the unique step difference as well as with the user specified step difference. Now there are again other functions. Like there is one important function called random function. Its job is to generate the random number. So now suppose I'm interested to generate a single random number. See, this is very important functionality when you program something and you need to take the help of some random variable. So you can generate it using this function. So when you say only RA and it will generate a single random value. It is randomly generated. Okay, no any computations are done. But if you want the random numbers with particular dimension, like I want a 3x3 matrix of random number, so I should specify like this. The name of random function, RAND, and in bracket 3, specifying that 3 rows and 3 columns I want, and all the values will be randomly generated. You can have a look at the values generated. These are all randomly generated. But one thing you must be noticing here, that the values generated are in fractions. But sometimes you may need to work with the integer values. So we can easily convert this randomly generated set of fractional values to the integer one. Like I will take one more matrix. I would like to generate a matrix of random numbers with 2 rows and 3 columns. So look at the matrix generated. All are the random values generated. But suppose I want that it should be the set of random values, but it should be in the integer form. So see how we can do this. We can go for something like this. We generate some random number. A single random number we will generate here. This we are generating. So of course it will be in fraction, and once it is generated in fraction, we will convert it to the integer representation. So there is one built-in construct called floor. It will take your integer part of the generated random number. For example, I generate this. So RAND generated 0.7570. And to this, we applied a floor function, so it will take only integer part. So integer part consists of only 0. Fractional part consists of 0.7575. So every time, if you take something like this, you take floor of random 3. So you can guess what we will be getting as a result of this command. First, random 3, it will generate a 3 by 3 matrix of random values. All those values will be in fractions. Okay, and you must have observed that those values are below 1. And then you are taking floor of it. It means from every fractional value, you are omitting the fractional part and you are taking only the integer part. So this will give you the matrix of zeros because we have taken a floor. But this is not useful for us. We want to take care of the fraction. Like I want to take care here, take care of 0.84, 0.11, 0.59. So you can simply go on performing some operation. Like I take random 3 and I multiply it with say 100. Okay. And then over this, I apply the floor function. Okay. So floor random. Floor is applied to this random function and multiplied with 100. Now let us have a look at this. So we multiplied the random value generated with 100. So your decimal point is getting shifted by 2 towards right hand side. And then you will be getting something like this, 82.34. And to this value, you have applied the function floor. Just a minute. Yeah. So this way we can make use of the function called random and floor. There is another built-in construct called magic. The purpose of this command is to generate a magical matrix of say given dimension. Like I generate a magic 3. So it is a 3 by 3 matrix. And see how they are placed. Okay. If I generate a magic 2, so it is a 2 by 2 magical matrix generated. Then there is a function called sum. If you recall that concatenation we did, like ANS, if we see, it is 2 by 2 matrix. We will take data available in X. It is a linear vector. We have two values here. Now, if I want to perform sum of these elements, so there is a built-in construct called sum. You can apply that sum on the given vector. You will be getting addition of the numbers. So floor, also we have explored, some. Now these are sufficient functions that are useful for exploring any kind of toolbox. Now let us begin with the image processing toolbox. We will explore basic functionalities of the image processing. So when we say image processing, what picture comes in our mind that we need to work on the images, we need to read the images, perform some operation on those images, and finally let us display the result out of it. Like I want to perform some cryptographic operations on the image. So I need to read that image in my environment so that it will be available in the raw form. Like I can access that image pixel by pixel, operate over those pixel values, and then you can perform the cryptographic operations, and finally you can display the resultant image after encryption. So we will go through the basic steps of image processing here. Like if you want to work on some image, that image must be available in your work environment. So my work environment is this. I'm working here in MATLAB. So I want image to be loaded over here. Okay. So that should be available in raw form. Even I should be able to manage that image pixel by pixel. Okay. So how to do that? Here in MATLAB, we have many functions available. We can directly use those functions and can perform different operations on image. So for example, I take here, now this time I'll be experimenting with the MATLAB script. I will go on typing my code over here. So it will be saved as a M file, and then step by step we can execute. So I just want to have one variable for row, and there I'm having the value as 256, and another variable as column, there I would like to have value as 256. Why I have done this? I want to have 256 by 256 size of the image. Okay, so I'm mentioning here dimension. Okay. Now this is the only size, and I will generate something here as an image. So let us take one variable called img. See, all these names are given by us. These are not the standard names. So let us generate the image with this particular size. So like I generate here image with this size. So I will mention something like this: row, comma, column. This is the size of image. But what should get generated out of it with this size? Let us generate some random numbers. So you already experimented this. You have seen how random works. Like random 2 comma 3, if we say, it will generate a matrix of random numbers of size 2 by 3. Now here our size is 256 by 256. Okay. So these are all the random values generated. Okay. So if we say run, I will put here semicolon. If you don't put here semicolon, the output will be immediately displayed in your console. So I'm terminating here by semicolon and clicking on run. My file is executed. I have kept the same file name and title, and extension is .m. So size is taken as 256 by 256, and the image is generated. But you don't know that how this image will look like, because we have generated it with the help of random variables. So let us have a look at the values in this variable img. You expect here 256 by 256 values. So as soon as I type here image, so many values will be displayed. Look at this. These are generated by the random function. And see, every value is a fractional value here. Okay. Now what we will do next, we have generated these many random values. And now we will show this as an image. So when you work with the image related operations, we show our results with a figure window. It means the place where you can display the images after operation or before operation. So I will take figure window, say figure 1 I am taking, and here I would like to show whatever I have generated in img. So this is no any meaningful image. This is just something randomly we created, and we just want to show it as the image. So let us have a look at it, how it looks. Now see, this is scrambled, because what we generated, we generated something random, and those values are taken as the intensity values, because you are saying I am show image. Okay. Now we will do something different. Like see here, I am doing rounding up with the values of the image. Say if I say round, this is the built-in construct, and if I say round img, so I just rounded up the values. For example, let us have a look at the values of image. We have 0.0998 as one possible value. So when we round this value, it is more close to zero. So it should get rounded to zero. But if you look at this value, 0.8954, it is more close to one. So it will get rounded to one. So when you say rounding of the values here, see, either it will get rounded to zero or one, because of the nature of the values you have here. So after this, we say something like image, then round image. So here we are rounding the values available here, and I will close the figure window, and I will again run this. Now observe the difference in the output. Earlier you got some gray shade in this image, but here it is completely black and white. So it is a binary image. Okay, very basic category of the image. There the pixel intensity values are either black or white, 0 or 1. So you can check the size of image here. For example, let us check. I will shift this up and clear out the screen. Let us check size of IMG. We have displayed IMG as the image. So size is the function. It is of course 256 by 256 because we created this image with the specified size. So like this, we can create the images from raw data. But this is not useful in our example. We just created the scrambled image and we displayed it. Now let us have some built-in images from the MATLAB environment and let us operate on those images. So for image processing purpose, there are built-in images like a moon image is there in this environment, or rice image is there, LiNA image. This is the most popular one. You will find this LiNA image in many research papers. So let us load those images and let's see how we can work with those images. So I will remove this set of steps. And now let us take one image in variable say A, and you want to take this image from the MATLAB environment. So you are about to read the image, and the functionality for that is imread. It stands for you are going to read the image. Which image? The name of image I know, which is available here, is moon image, and the extension of this image is tag image format. So it is a TIFF image. So when you read something from your computer, either you give the complete path. If you want to read the specific image from particular path, here you can start from say D colon something like that. But my image is available in the same environment with the same directory. So see what is the statement I wrote. I'm about to read the image. Which is the image? Moon image. The image format is tagged image format, and the name of image is enclosed in the single quote. So when you say run, the image is read. It means the image is now available in variable A. So when you type variable A here, what do you expect? You expect the pixel values. See, these are the pixel values of the image. Like the moon image you read, there you have intensity values are like somewhere 2, somewhere 10, 12, something like that. Okay. So in, this is actually a grayscale image, and we have the gray label intensities from 0 to 255. So we have successfully read the image, and it is available in variable A. Now let us read. Let us see how this image looks like. So we will try to display this image using imShow. And when I click on Run, just have a look at this image. This is the moon image. This is a grayscale image, and the intensity values are observed as gray intensities from 0 to 255. Like there are dark intensities, there are light intensities at this point, the moderate intensity is over here. So this is the stored image or available image we have taken. Let us take another image, say in variable B, and that image I am taking as peepers.png. This is again also available in this environment. This is the standard image, and the image format I am using here is portable network graphics. So see, both the images are of different format. So B we have read, and let us have a look at intensity values of B. If you type B, first we'll run this, read the B, and now let us have the values. See, these are the values. These are the intensity values. Because it is the RGB image, it is a color image. So there are three color planes, red, green, and blue. So when it is presented in the matrix form, you'll be getting three different matrices for the operation. Okay. So this is the image B. We just want to have a look at this image, how it looks. So I will show image B here. I will remove this, otherwise again, it will show us the image moon. So just have a look at image B, how it looks. So it is a color image. It seems to be the RGB image. Now, so far we have read successfully two images. One is the gray level, another is the RGB color image. We can check the size of image over here. See, let us check the size of image A. It is 537 by 558. And let us check size of image B. The size is 384 by 512. But additionally, you are observing here 3. This is because of the image is RGB. 3 color planes are there. So you will be getting 3 matrices here for 3 different color planes. Okay. But in case of A, we got only 1 matrix of 537 by 538. So looking at the size of image A and image B, they seems to be different. Size of both the images are different. Now suppose I want to add these two images, but I know that both the images are of different type. So I need to bring them to the same type, and I need to bring them to the same size as well, and then only the operations can be possible. So what we will do, we will check the size of B first. The size of B is 384 by 384. So let us resize image A. So we will resize image A. The function available for that is im resize. So we are going to resize the image. Im resize. What we are going to resize? Image A. And what should be the dimension of this image? The one which we have for image B, this one. So we want 384 rows and we want 5, 1, 2, 1. So this command will resize our image A with this new dimension 384 by 512. And this resize image again we will have in the same variable. We are not reflecting it to the new object. Okay, so let us see the resize is done. Now see the size of A. Size of A is 384 by 512. And if you check size of B is again 384 by 512. But we are worried about this component. We have 3 over here. This is because our image is RGB image. Okay. Now, we will try to add both the images. Like, we will try to add A. I am add A. And I am add A, comma B. And this addition, we will hold in some object, say, but it's very clear that this operation will not be successful here. Reason is you are trying to add the images of the same size, but you are trying to add the images of two different types. One is the gray level and another is the RGB image. So what we can do is we can convert the RGB image to the gray level representation. For that, we have, like here I will do, I will here first resize A and resize so that the entire script can be run. So I am resize A and size we gave here. Let me see the size of B. 384 by 512. So here 384 space 512. And resize is done. Let us check for just a minute. Sorry for the inconvenience. So we have resized here and we have shown the image B. So image is listed. Now what we are trying to do here is we are trying to add two images by im add, and those two images are A and B, and we will not succeed in this operation. The reason is both are of different types. We got here the error. So what we can do is we can change the RGB image to the gray level representations. For that, let us convert our image B to the gray level representation. So I can have B equals to the built-in functionality is RGB to gray. It means you are going to convert RGB image to gray level. Which image you want to convert? Image B. And after conversion, the image is, that image is available in variable B only. So I will remove this and let us see how it works. IAM add is not possible, so I will remove this IAM add, and I am now only converting my RGB image to the gray level representation. Just have a look at this, how this image looks like. So I am sure B, if I say, it should show us the gray level representation. And this was our earlier PNG image, portable network graphics, and now we have it in gray format. And now we can go for the addition of two grayscale images. So we can have something like this, C equals to IAM add, and we want to add image A. Recall that image A is the gray image of moon, and image B is now the gray image of peepers. Okay. So if we say IAM add, and if I remove this IAM show here, IAM add is done. Yes, it is successful. We are not getting any error message. And now let us display what is the result of this IAM add. So we should get it as a combination of these two images. So you must be observing here the addition. Basically, in background, what happens? The intensity values are getting added. Like the pixel value at particular location in image A is getting added with the pixel value at the same location in image B. But if it exceeds see what is the range we have? We have total 256 intensity values. But if it exceeds the upper limit, it will freeze there itself at the upper limit. So this is the result of addition of two grayscale images. Similarly, we can go for the subtraction of two grayscale images. For that, we can use a function IAM subtract, and let us see what it generates. See, the intensity values are getting subtracted. From A, B is getting subtracted. So subtraction is happening means intensity values are decreasing. Intensity values are decreasing means they are more close to zero. And zero means black. Black means dark. That's why the subtraction result is darker here. Okay. In addition, intensity values are getting added. So they are more close to the upper limit, 255. So more close to upper limit means more close to white, more close to bright. So this is the result of subtraction we have. Similarly, we can go for the multiplication of the images. Even we can go for the complement of the images. For example, here we go for complement of image A. So let us see. I go for the built-in function. I am complement, and I want to complement image A. So complement operation is known to everyone. So image A is the moon image. If we take its complement, so intensity values will be complemented. See how it looks. Look at the complemented image here. In the original image, this was entirely black, the background. Okay. In complement, it has become white. Similarly, then after subtracting from 255, the intensity values are changed, and the complemented image is available here. Even you can multiply two images. You can save the result of your operation as an image only. Like if you want to save this C, you can go for the operation called IAM write. You can go for this IAM write operation, and the image will get saved. So there are different ways of working with the images. There are three basic conversions in image processing. Like if you are working with say satellite images, and you are only concerned with the two intensities, either black or white. So you will work on the binary images. There you have either zeros or ones. But if your research work is based on the gray level intensity. So you need to work you need to work with the images of the gray level. So you should be able to convert them to the gray level representation and then work over them. Similarly, if you are working with the RGB images, then you need to take care of all the three color planes. So these three image representations are important. So now, so far, we know how to load the image in our working environment. Once it is available in the form of matrix, we can manipulate with that image. Like we can handle the intensities as per our requirement. One important task is like you can filter the images. For example, if I have some blur image and I want to remove that blur effect. So that can be done by some set of operations. If I want to segment out a particular portion, so segmentation is possible. If I want to detect the edges of the images, that's also possible. So we will have a look at some filters in the image processing. So when we apply filter to image, it means we want to remove something called as noise, or we want to improve the quality of the image. We call it as the image enhancement. Like you may sharpen the image, or you may make that image smooth if required. Sharp means you will make the boundaries sharp, you will make those boundaries visible, like that. So we will go for the filtering, two, three kinds of filtering here. Like those who are from the image processing background, they must be knowing what is the average filter, what is the Gaussian filter. So I will show you here one demonstration. I will remove the earlier execution. And now let us have one image in variable x. Say I have the same image we will take, moon.tip. Okay. And we will perform some filtering operation over here. Let us go for the average filter. I will show you in the result what is happening by the average filter. So when you filter the image, in technical terms, you apply the filter mask to that image. So that mask need to be generated. So here I generate a filter mask. I will not go in the detail how the filter mask is generated. So F special is the built-in construct that allows to generate the filter mask. So I'm generating here filter mask for the average filter. The name of filter is average. I will show you what is happening because of average. Okay. So we have the image with us. We have the filter mask with us. We just need to apply this filter mask to our image X. That's it. Your filtering will be done. So here I perform IM filter. It means I'm going to filter image A with filter mask H. Okay. And the result of this filtering, I would like to hold in some, this is not A, we have the image in variable X. And the result after filtering, I would like to hold in variable A. So see what we have done. We have taken one image. We have taken a filter mask. How filtering happens? This filter mask is applied to the image. And if you go in theoretical way, how to apply the filter mask, we actually shift that window from a particular size like 3x3 over the set of pixels, over 2x2 matrix X. Okay. So IM filter means you are going to filter the image X with this filter mask. And then we will see how our filter image look like. And later we will see how the filter image is different from the original one. So let us have a look at this. This is what we have displayed after filtering out. We don't know, or even we are not able to compare presently how it is different from the original image. So what we will do here, we will add one facility that will allow us to display both original image and the filtered image side by side. So that facility is called subplot. We are going to have a subplot here. What this subplot will do, it will divide your figure window according to the dimension given by you. Like I'm giving you a dimension 1, 2. It means I want to divide my figure window into one row and two columns. So I'll be getting two cells, right? So subplot 1, 2, I'm getting two cells. And in the first cell, I would like to put the original image. So I am show here I will put original image which is available in variable x. Okay, let's see what happens. Let us focus to this statement. What we have done by subplot, we divided our figure window into one row and two columns. So one row, two columns means two cells we got. And out of those two cells, in the first cell, I am going to display my original image. Let us see how it looks. Now see, this time your image is now shifted towards left hand side. Why? Because this figure window is now divided into two parts, or two cells. Okay. Now let us use the second cell. So in subplot, your dimension was 1/2. And in the second cell, I mentioned here 2. I want to show the filtered image. That filtered image is available in variable AC. Here we have performed filtered array. So it is there. Now let us have a look. If we click on run, now see, this left hand side is your original one and right hand side is filtered one. Okay. Can you see the difference between these two? In original, you find the sharp boundaries. While after performing average filtering, see the boundaries are smooth here. Look at this pattern of the moon in original image. Here it is smooth. So average filter is a smoothening filter. It has smoothened out your image. So wherever you don't want sharp edges or sharp features, then you can go for the average filter. Okay. So this was the average filter. Now, what if you want the sharp features? Let us go for the another filter. I will remove this out and I'll take the same image, say moon dot tip. Okay. And now I apply a different filter mask because I don't want to use average filter. Average gave me the smoothening effect. I will take another filter mask. So F special will allow me to take the filter mask. And the filter I am taking here is, say, Laplacian filter. Okay, let us see what happens by Laplacian filter. So you have an image with you. You have a filter mask with you. Now let us perform filtering. We will go for IM filter. Filter the image X with the mask H. And result of this filtering, let us hold in a variable A. Okay. Now let us run this and see what happens. The filtering is done, but if you show the image A, see how it looks. After applying a filter, you have focused to the dark intensities and you are able to see the sharp boundaries of the objects in your image. Now see what we can do and what will be the meaning of it. If I do something like this, B equals to X minus A. Okay. So X is my original image and A is something what I got after filtering. And then if I show, show B, it should display something else. See what it will display. So I have done something different here. Okay. This difference you will not be able to note in this figure. Let us take the help of subplot and then we will be able to differentiate. For example, subplot I do, I divide the figure window into two cells and in the first cell, I would like to display the original image that is in X. And then in the second cell, subplot 1, 2, the second cell contains this image B. Now let us run this. Now note the difference. This leftmost is your original image and the rightmost is the filtered image with Laplacian filter. Okay, so you can note the difference here. The boundaries are sharp here. Okay, and when we compared it with the average filter in the previous example, average filters smoothen out the boundaries. Even we found the boundaries more sharp in the original image, but after average filter, those were smooth. And just have a look at the result of Laplacian see the boundaries, how they are here in the resultant image. So they are sharp now. Okay. So that is the difference in averaging and Laplacian. Like this is about the filtering. Now suppose I want to work with the edges of the image, same image we will take in say variable A, and the image is say moon dot T. We are using the same grayscale image, and I want to extract the edges of this image. So there is the edge operator here. We use that edge operator. We want to extract edges from image A, and the edge to be detected by Sobel edge detector. These are the standard edge detectors like Sobel, Kani. This must be known to the people who are working in the image processing area. So I want to detect the edges with the Sobel, and after detecting this, I would like to have in some variable called. I just want to detect the edges, and let us display B here. Okay. Now you will be able to see only the edges. Look at this result. You know how your original image is. It is the gray level image, and when you applied Sobel edge detector, all the edges are detected here. Okay. Now how they are detected? Let us see. If I change here, instead of Sobel, there is another edge detector called Kani. And now see what difference it will make if you say Kani. See how Kani is detecting the edges. And in earlier example, you have seen how Sobel have detected the edges. For example, I will put here another variable called C, and their edge I am detecting with the help of Sobel edge detector. And now we will have a subplot. We will divide into two cells. In the first cell, let us display the result of Sobel, and in the second cell, let's display the result of Kani. Okay, now it will be more clear. Even you can give names or labels to this. See, the leftmost result is of Sobel, and the rightmost result is of Kani. So you can note the difference what Sobel is doing and what Kani is doing. See, all the intermediate, even small edges are detected here by the Kani edge detector. Are you able to see the results, madam? Okay. So this is about the edge detection. Like histogram is again important component here in image processing. Histogram is nothing but you can plot the frequency of the intensity values of the image. Like a particular intensity, how many times it has occurred in the image. Like say intensity value 56. So how many pixels are there in the image with the intensity value 56? So if I take one image, like same, I'll take moon dot, and if I go for its histogram, there is a built-in construct called imhist. It will plot that histogram for A. So here it is take time. You can have a plot. It will be a two-dimensional plot actually. There you can get the dimension as a two-dimensional plot, and there you can observe the intensity values. See 0 to 255, and these are the number of pixels for each intensity, how many pixels are there. So there are some intensity values for which no pixels available, but you can see intensity values which are close to zero, for that you have the highest count. Okay. So if you recall moon image, moon dot TIFF image, what did you find? what type of intensities are more there, the dark intensity values or light intensity values. For example, I show you that image. I'm show A there. See, you have more intensity value close to black, dark. So in your histogram, you observe that your intensity values close to black, they are more, like this count is. So it is nothing but a graph or a plot between the intensity values versus their count, how many times they are occurring. So like there are many more things to explore with the MATLAB environment. I just plan today to introduce you with the MATLAB environment, and my plan was to just demonstrate the basic functionalities and how one can start with the image processing. Even you can take it ahead for the video processing. You can read the stored videos. There are built-in constructs like AVI read, MM reader is there. If you want to work on the real-time video, then by Win Video you can capture the real-time video, and frame by frame you can process on that video. So from my side, I would like to conclude here today. If there are questions, I would like to take those questions. Hello? Madam, I would like to conclude now. Are there any questions? Hello? Hello? Hello, am I audible, ma'am? Yeah, I would like to conclude now. So if there are questions, I would like to take those questions.
Hello, ma'am. Hello.
Yeah.
Hello.
Yes, ma'am, there is echo from your end.
Yeah, that's my device was on. Okay, ma'am, you can conclude it today.
Yeah.
There is no such questions are available right now.
Okay, if you want, I can share the presentation with you.
Yes,
you can forward it to the participants.
Fine, ma'am, you do that. You whatever the material you have, ma'am, that you can go through.
Yeah.
Mainly related to mathematical functions.
Yeah, there is a question from Dr. Latha, ma'am.
Yeah,
I have not explored with the derivatives, ma'am, because I have never been into that domain. So yeah, there are functionalities available. See, in wavelet transform also a lot of complex mathematical operations are performed. So we just need to know what are the names of functions in MATLAB. That's it. Okay, ma'am.
Thank you for your kind cooperation and your valuable time which you have given for this session.
That was an opportunity for me that I could contribute something from my side. No problem.
We are expecting the same in future as well, ma'am.
Sure, ma'am. Yeah. Thank you. Thank you all participants. Best luck.
Thank you.